So the RCA's mission is to support the circular economy in Alberta. And so as part of that, we noticed that there's a lack of recycling or composting capacity in the province of Alberta. And so we looked to the example of Stickland Farms and said, you know what, they're doing an awesome job of benefiting their own farm as well as benefiting the communities around them by providing this service of composting food scraps, like household organic waste. So we said, why don't we come up with a guide that will help farmers and landowners to go down the same path and do something similar. So this webinar is supposed to be complementary to the document. So the guide is now available. So if you go into the Recycling Council of Alberta website under resources, there's a link to the guide and you can actually download the guide. And we also, I guess my last intro piece here is to say thank you to the Government of Alberta as well as the Government of Canada for supporting this project through the Canadian Agricultural Partnership, who provided funding, as well as our contributors. There was a number of contributors, including John Paul, who's on the call, so thank you. So we've got three presenters today who are going to be talking a little bit about their own experience with on-farm composting, as well as the benefits for their farms. The first, so we'll go through our three presenters, and then afterwards we'll take questions. Either you can put up your hand or you can put a question into the chat box. Our first presenter today is Colby Hansen. Colby operates a mixed farm northwest of Edmonton, where he grows and raises cattle. He's committed to the concept of regenerative agriculture and will be putting alt-root compost on his land to increase soil health, water retention, and crop production. Colby is planning to work with research groups like the Gateway Research and the University of Alberta to run a large-scale farm trial on the benefit of compost as a fertilizer. So that's exciting because not a lot of work has been done in that area so far. So thank you very much, Colby. Go ahead. You've got about 10 minutes and then I will introduce the next speaker.
All right. Good morning, everyone. I'd like to thank the RCA for inviting me today. I'm a newbie to the compost industry, so my personal experiences so far have derived from hundreds of hours of research and development. Myself and my family operate a fourth generation 460 head 3500 acre cow calf background and finishing operation, as well as grow our own feed and grains for our herd. My wife runs Hansen Beef, in which we are marketing 100 beef as well as 40 free range pork direct to consumers a year. Our ranch is located close to the Tuatha Valley, which is 20 minutes east of Westlock. In the past 2 years, I have been hard at work transitioning our operation to regenerative agricultural practices. The practices we have and are still in process of implementing are rotational grazing, integration of livestock on crop residue, grass calving, 60-day to calving weaning, growing protein supplements, growing plants to eliminate bloat, backgrounding and finishing calves out on the land, intercropping, cover cropping, swath, bale, corn, and stockpiled forage grazing, eliminating fungicides, pesticides, and insecticides, reducing herbicides, and use of organic fertilizer and seed treatments. My interest in compost has stemmed from a desire to switch from synthetic to organic fertilizer to utilize waste resources that are best applied to regenerating soils and our environment. It has taken myself and partners many years and dedication to build the business we have created. Compost is one of many tools the farmer can utilize in his holistic practices. It is wonderful to see the RCA as well as communities alternative route have met with recognize the importance of composting going towards building healthier soils. With companies like General Mills and McCain's pledging to source their products from holistically managed farms in the near future, there is no question that compost going to properly stewarded lands is a key to everyone's positive impact on climate change. Myself and partners' passions and values lie in making positive change in our communities, local economies, environment, and food we grow. Our company, Alternative Root, includes Brian Wanacott, who also farms with his family as well as operates Elevate Ag and Organics, in which Brian and his partner currently manage 40,000 ton of feedlot compost per year. Brad Abel, the president of Keytec, is our other partner. Keytec has traditionally been in the oil field industry for the last 40 years, but have expanded into the renewable sector. They have incineration technology for landfills, as well as biosolid treatment technology. We have been fortunate to have partnered with the Westlock Landfill, where we are set to take in 20,000 ton of organics per year, with hopes of expanding to 40,000 ton in the future. Our operation will involve covered aerated static piling, in which we will turn into cured compost within 6 weeks. When the compost is cured, it will be hauled to my operation, windrowed, and spread. We will have one full-time employee as well as one part-time employee when our operation starts. Our holdup at this time is waiting for our registration to be approved by the Alberta Environment. Our anticipated approval, we have been told from AEP, is within the next 2 weeks. Our company's goal is to expand to other municipalities and partner with farmers who practice regenerative ag. Our intentions are to work directly with communities on educating the public of the benefits of composting, holistic management, also working with producers and independent research groups, as well as universities and colleges, to gather the data in which we will assist our producers to make the switch to regenerative agriculture. And I guess my last point I'd like to bring up is that farmers around the world have a great opportunity to heal our planet and make a positive change by working with nature. As farmers, we experience the impact of climate change and environmental disasters happening firsthand, in which directly affect our way of life environmentally, emotionally, mentally, and financially. So the time is now to bring urban and rural people together to make positive change for our future generations. Thank you for having me today. It was a pleasure to share my thoughts.
Thank you, Colby. That was fantastic. I suspect that there's going to be a lot of questions for you now, as well as when you get up and running and are doing a little bit, like when you're actually, when you've got your license in hand and are operating. Don't go anywhere, because we'll have some questions for you coming up here. So our next speaker is John Paul. John Paul presented on our first webinar as well on the actual process around getting set up and what the operations look like. John Paul has been involved with all aspects of composting, compost facility design, and compost use for almost 30 years. He's raised on a dairy farm in British Columbia and has an agriculture degree from the University of Alberta and a PhD in soil science from the University of Guelph. He's worked as a waste management scientist with Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada for 7 years, and he's been designing compost facilities since 1998. He's passionate about returning organic matter and nutrients to soils safely and effectively, and is generally a great go-to resource for all things compost related. So take it away, John Paul. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jeannie. Welcome aboard the composting world. I'm going to speak particularly about Stickland Farms, and I pass on greetings from Brian Stickland and also from Ray Wolf, the compost operator, both of whom I've known for a lot of years. And both Brian and Ray would have loved to be on here. Brian's a little shy and Ray is on holidays, so I get to speak on their behalf. So Stickland Farms is a large grain farm near Penhold, Alberta. They have a history of using compost. So they use compost from Bowden Institution back 20 years ago when they were composting and saw the benefit of the compost on their soils. And then when Bowden Institution stopped doing it, then Brian said, well, I'm going to take a crack at it because it sounds like it's good for me. So it's been a big learning exercise, and part of what the objective of this presentation is to help you all learn from what Brian's experience has been. And having said that, I'm working with another farm composter in Alberta, They just started composting 3 weeks ago, and they got it right the first time. They got their first load of source-separated organics from Edmonton, and within 48 hours, it was nicely cooking at 65 degrees and 16% oxygen. So that was great to learn from great people like Brian and Ray. So some of the key learning is aeration reduces odor. Your working surface is really important, and non-compostable material adds cost. So naively, many of us who are on the farm are very familiar with organic waste and manure, and it's generally clean. There's no non-compostables, no plastics in it. And it's a, it's a big wake-up call when we see so much plastic and other messy material in some of the material that comes to the farms. And lastly, the compost has a long-term value for the soil. So when Brian first started composting, he was in that world of, oh yeah, we can do this, I'm a farmer, I can be resourceful, and so let's bring it on. So he began with no aeration, and shall we say the neighbors were quite well aware of his operation. And so then he thought, okay, we've got to change this a little bit. We can't frustrate the neighbors. So he started experimenting with aerated piles. So he bought some HDP pipe, he bought some little playground blowers, and he started aerating. And what he found was the odor was significantly reduced. So happy to say now, and I just spoke with Ray a couple of days ago, the greatest source of odor from their facility is the incoming material. And so particularly in the summer months, the source separated food waste sits in people's garbage cans. They sit in larger bins before they come to the farm. And there's no telling what interesting odors are coming when the load gets in. So the key is getting that material in process as quickly as possible. With Stickland Farms, their goal is to do it within a week. with the other operation we're working on, the goal is to get it in the windrows within 2 hours. The other big learning that Brian and Ray had learned was, well, they began with 4-inch HDE pipes. Now they're upgraded to 8-inch because they realized more air is a lot better. So they turn the material after 10 to 14 days. And they have to turn this material in that time period because they'll get a foot for a foot and a half of bone dry material really around the pipe. So it's an incredible drying procedure. What they realize too is they do need to add water. So the additional air is really exciting for minimizing odor, but it dries the material quicker. And so they have found that they have to add water. So in terms of planning for that, that is important. That they're able to process much faster. In 4 weeks, the stuff is ready to go to the field, if you will. Which all means that they can process much more material on the pad. And that leads us to the topic of the working surface. Working surface is important. When Brian started, he used the clay pad. They had clay on the farm. It's easy to make a clay pad. You move some stuff around. Works really great in many months of the year, but it doesn't work that great when during snowmelt or in the fall or in some of the summers that we've had, including a couple of years ago when things got really wet and they had accessibility challenges. So two things happened. They couldn't turn the piles, they couldn't mix the material. So we have increased risk of odor, and even some of the trucks weren't able to bring the material in, which is not so good for the contracts. So at the moment they have a 3-acre asphalt surface for a more durable working surface that's working really well. So that's their primary working area where the mixing and the aerated composting occurs. The second site that we've been working on actually has a a roller compacted concrete surface. And that's been a really excellent surface as well. One of the challenges with asphalt is it does get a little bit softer when the under the high temperatures. So the benefit of the finished compost is actually the reason that Sticklin started composting in the first place. They're still learning and they're seeing the benefit of compost. When I spoke with Ray a few days ago, I said, you know what, I know you're not a soil scientist and I know you're a composter, not a farmer per se. What do you see when you drive to the farm? And his observations was, you know, as he drove to work, he could see that all of the crops germinated really, really well. And in particular, this is in comparison to other fields around, and the crops actually look fuller. So in years where precipitation may be more challenging, either too much or too little, is when we see the real benefit of the compost as well. So really, compost provides much more than simply fertilizer nutrients. So lastly, the non-compostable material costs money. And so that has to be taken into account before you start. Sadly enough, there's a substantial amount of non-compostable material in our community's organic waste. It has to be removed from the odors. It must not blow around the site, so appropriate fencing is important, and it must not be applied to the soil. So we need to take it out because we're more and more concerned about plastics and microplastics. And at the end of the day, we are going to need to work with our communities to reduce the amount of film plastic going back to the farm. The farm is where the organic material should be going for the benefit of the soil and our planet, but we've got to work together to keep it clean, so to speak. And that's the end of my presentation. So thank you. I'll be happy to take questions afterwards as well. It's been a pleasure being with you all. Thank you.
Thank you, John Paul. Just a reminder, everybody, you can put notes if you've got questions, put them into the chat right away and we'll sort of keep tally of them and we can answer them after. I don't see anything, I don't think, in there right now. So get these guys on their toes, ask them some questions. All right, so our next panelist is Andrea Strobisawa. And Andrea, she let me choose my most exciting parts of her bio to introduce her by, and you'll find that it's most of it, actually. I'm pretty excited. So Andrea is the fourth generation of the Holtman family to manage the family-owned Shipwheel Cattle Feeders Limited, which is located near Taber, Alberta. The operation currently includes a yearling grazing program, a 5,500 head feedlot, as well as cropland, bees, and pasture-raised chickens. And the operation also includes various forms of compost. So I think Andrea is sort of focusing on one of them today, but she's composting all kinds of things in all kinds of ways. Since she was born, she's been immersed in using the principles of holistic management in operating her family farm and ranch. And now as the owner and operator, she faces the unique challenge of staying true to those holistic goals in this changing, complex agricultural industry. She's passionate about using the principles of holistic management, increasing the storage of carbon in the soil, using proper stock handling to heal and maintain healthy animals and children, and helping to respect and appreciate the presence of women in agriculture. So thank you, Andrea. Take it away.
Okay, so thank you for the introduction and for asking me to speak. I'll kind of share what I know. I always start off by saying, just because it works for me on our place doesn't necessarily mean that it'll work for you on your place, but I'm always keen to kind of share what we're doing and hopefully you can take something and apply it to your own operation. And I am always keen to do the same thing from everyone I listen to as well. So we started doing compost, actually my dad started doing compost pre-2009. He can't really remember when it was, maybe 2007. And he went to a composting class down in the States, and he came back and he decided that he was going to start composting. And the compost teacher that he went to said, you know, when you get back, like, don't go crazy, don't do too much, like, start slow, maybe do one windrow, you don't want to risk too much. And that's just not really how Dad does things. So he came back and he actually composted all of the manure from and the bedding from our feedlot. So he started out with 20,000 tons. That was his like first kick in the can. And the composting teacher came to our house and said, well, like, how did he wanted to see what Dad was doing? And he said, how did it go? How was your first, like, you started off slow? And Dad said, no, I have 20,000 ton out there, and so far it's going really well. So the first challenge was getting NRCB approval on our compost pad. Our compost pad is actually L-shaped, just because of how it fit with the pens and all the proper setbacks from the road. And we did ours on clay. So it's built on compacted clay, 0.5 meters thick, with this specific density that somebody way smarter than me would have to explain to you. But so we started out, we put out the compost pad, and we started out when we were turning, we had a person that would come in and custom turn it for us, but he kind of went by the wayside. And so we had to hurry up and find our own way of doing it. So we did end up buying a turner, but that was also another challenge that we had. So this is kind of the start of our compost pad. And we start off by, when I clean the pens, we clean the pens typically once a year. And when I clean the pens, we usually will pre-scrape them. So we kind of pile all the manure and the bedding together. And we have to make sure that we're doing it in the right conditions. So it doesn't work to do it if it's really, really wet. And we hope, not like this year, but we hope that it's got a little bit of moisture in it as we're kind of pre-scraping them and getting it all into a pile. So the high hole will come in and it'll pre-scrape all the pens and kind of pile all the manure and bedding together and give it a little bit of a mix. And then we load it into the manure trucks. And then the manure trucks, let's see if I can get this to go to the next one. So then the manure trucks will come and they line up. We're gonna give them a straight line and they back up into the row there and they just slowly spin the manure and the bedding off into those windrows. And so doing that kind of gives it its first aeration. Each row is 27 feet from the middle of that one row to the middle of the next row. And they spin it off really nice and slow. It works really well for them. They don't have to bounce through a field and use a whole bunch of fuel to get it off. It's just really simple. They back up to the windrow and very slowly spin it off. We try not to make the rows too high, and we try not to spin it off too fast because then it creates too much material on the inside of the row. So the top picture there is what we have to do before we can even go to the process of turning it is just cleaning in between the rows. So once we get it all cleaned up in between the rows after they've spun it off onto the compost pad, then we can go ahead and start taking temperatures. Usually it activates right then just from the act of spinning it off the manure trucks. So the next thing that we do is we'll take temperatures. So usually we hope that it'll kind of activate between that 130 and 140 degree Fahrenheit. And we watch it very, very carefully. We take multiple temperatures up all throughout the process. And as soon as it kind of gets up to 150, 160, it tells us it's time to turn it right away. And so we, like I said, we had to buy, we ended up purchasing a Sittler 1014 compost turner. And that just came out kind of out of necessity because all the people that were doing it custom they couldn't do it. They kind of stopped doing it. So this allows us, though, it kind of worked a little bit better because it allows us to do it exactly when we need to do it, and we don't have to wait for somebody to come in and do it for us. So that Sittler 1014, we don't actually own a tractor that will pull it. So we end up, there's a place that leases them or rents them in Tabor. And so we rent this tractor. It's a very large tractor, and we only end up putting about 50 to 100 hours on it. So it really doesn't pay for us to own a tractor that size, because that's the only use that we would have for it. So we lease this tractor, and we hook it up to our compost turner, and away we go. I went the wrong way. There we go. So that's the compost turner in action. It's very, very slow process at the beginning. We end up going about 0.1. It feels like you're barely crawling. And it takes, depending on how much material we have out there, it takes anywhere between 12 to 24 hours to turn it the first time. And the second and third time gets much, much easier and much faster as the material starts to break down. Then it takes, I always hesitate saying it takes exactly 6 weeks. It really depends on the material. It depends on how wet it is out there. It depends on how much is out there. It's more of an organic process than it is a scientific process. I know there is some science to it, but it takes anywhere between 4 to 8 weeks until we have cured compost that's not heating and activating anymore. And at that time, when we it usually ends up that it's there for fall application. So at that time, we will load it into the trucks that you see there, and they haul it to the dry corners of all the fields. And then we spread it on the fields after the crop's been taken off. And typically on this kind of application, we really like to use a vertical manure spreader instead of the horizontal manure spreader. The vertical spreader just gives it a really nice spread because it is a finer, drier material. We ended up learning kind of the hard way that hauling all of that compost to the field is best done more is better, therefore cheaper. We kind of learned the hard way that if we loaded it into the manure trucks to go and spread it, it actually ended up being not too cost effective. We haven't needed any of the compost or nutrients we get our soil tested every year. We haven't needed any of this compost on our own land for many years. So all of our compost gets sold to the neighboring farmers and some of the gardeners in Tabor. It works really well in my context because we have such really high value crops around us. There's corn and beets and potatoes and onions and pumpkins. And so all those really high value crops really see a big benefit from the compost. Some of my customers have really mentioned how much easier it is on their equipment to run their harrows or work their fields. And the water retention has been amazingly better. We sell pretty much all of our compost to the farmers that are around us. We don't really keep any of it unless our soil test calls for it, and it hasn't in years. This particular compost always ends up being a little bit higher in a bacterial count because it's very high in nitrogen, being the manure. We try to balance that off with using lots of bedding throughout the year. Some years we do, some years we don't. So, and on our particular soils, we really need a higher fungal count. We get our biology tested in our own soils. And so we've really been experimenting with trying to create this type of compost on this scale with a higher fungal count. So we've been experimenting with using wood chips and a few different things. And I've also had a customer that needed to add some calcium onto his soil. And so we actually ended up putting it into a windrow and hauling it to him. And so he applied it through the form of his compost row. So that's been a fun experiment. We also have tried experimenting a little bit with some cull onions and some peas and things like that. But what we find is it's just very costly to start adding all those ingredients. And the other thing that we found with the onions was we had the plastic, like John Paul mentioned, we ended up with plastic onion bags in our compost, and that's not ideal. So we really try to just stick to our own material that we can control. And the only thing that I run into every once in a while is some strings from the round bales from putting the bedding in the pens. But that's something that I can really control because it's my own staff that I can lay down the law with. So yeah, that's kind of what we do. Please ask me questions. I don't know if I covered everything that I can think of, but the other thing that we're kind of experimenting with and we're pretty new to is, like I said, the picture on the left there is our high fungal compost. And so that's, it's a Johnson Su bioreactor and it's highly aerated and filled more with carbon material. So to increase the fungal count. And then we're thinking about being able to like supercharge a few of the rows with the higher fungal count compost. And then the other new thing that we started doing this year was vermicomposting, and that's been really successful, but we're very, very new to it as well. So yeah, that's everything that I think I had, but please ask me lots of questions.
Okay, so it's questions time, everybody. I see that there's a couple of questions. I don't know if you want to join me, Christina. It's completely up to you, but there's a couple of questions right off the top. There's a question for John Paul asking about whether you had considered a recycled asphalt as a working surface at Stickland's farm, I imagine. Go ahead.
Yes. Part of the reason Brian actually didn't consider it. It is less costly and other people have used it. We actually used it on another site. I think the primary concern that Brian initially had was with how impermeable is it, and does it actually meet the liner requirement? So that's why it was left off the table. It might require a different impervious liner underneath, or more work has to be done on it. But it is a great product, and we have used it on other sites. So great question.
And Andrea and Colby, are you guys using, did you say you're using compacted clay liners, or what are you using for a working surface?
We just have clay.
We're using compacted clay, and then we're fortunate enough to use, there is a pile of concrete waste that we are getting grinded up, and we're going to use that mixed in with some recycled asphalt for a, I guess, our finished layer.
Excellent, thank you. There's another great question from Hank that asks about what percentage does the plastic make up of the compost loads, and how do the composters deal with the challenge? So I think that is, yeah, how much is coming in, and then how is it sort of separated and removed, and where does it go to? I guess is mainly a question for John Paul, right? Because I would, like, you're not really having that issue, Andrea. And Colby, have you encountered this plastic question yet?
Just through research, I guess, through other facilities. And we've found anywhere from as low as 3% contamination to as high as we've heard 50% contamination. So it really depends on the education of the community and how well they are, you know, teaching their residents is what we've found in our research.
I think another piece of that would be the policy and the bylaws in the municipality as well, how they're collecting the material, what their kind of rules are for how material goes into carts and all that kind of thing. I know some municipalities accept bagged compost and some don't, and so I think the bags sort of open the door a little bit to use other bags. What have you seen, John Paul?
Well, I've seen lots of things. So percentage is actually an interesting one, because typically the plastic is low in percentages because plastic is light. So what does it really mean? Like even 1% plastic, if you put that on your boulevard or near your home, you would get grouchy spouses or children or neighbors. No plastic is a good amount. The Canadian Council of Ministers for Environment, the guidelines. The Canadian guidelines suggest that in every half liter, there shouldn't be more than one piece of plastic that's greater than 1 inch. And there should be no sharps of any kind. So that's the regulation. But we got to remember two things. One is plastic is very visible. And the second thing is plastic smaller than 1 inch or much smaller than 1 inch, microplastic. There has been research that has demonstrated that it can be taken up directly into the plants. It's a fascinating mechanism, but that's a particular concern with root crops because we don't want little bits of plastics taken up into root crops. So it's an ongoing challenge that we as composters have, but it's a challenge we share with our neighboring communities. How do we do this better? How much plastic have we seen typically from a homeowner's organic material? There's typically less plastic because there's more accountability or more potential accountability. It's the commercial material that can be really high in plastic. The worst that I've seen is the City of Toronto's organic waste that was 25% plastic by weight of the finished compost, which is, it's definitely more plastic than compost.
So were there some mechanisms like separators and depackers and things that can be used at the front end to try and take it out as it's received? Is that something that Brian does?
Yeah, so Brian doesn't take it out at the front end. He takes it out the back end. One of the challenges with trying to remove it all at the front end is that it takes a lot of hand picking if you're doing it by hand. If you're trying to do it with a screen, the organic material sticks to the plastic. So you end up with a lot of organics that will have to be discarded if you do it at the front end. If you do it at the back end, typically, and the City of Whitehorse, for example, they run all their compost through a 1/4-inch stainless steel screen. Most of the visible plastic is in the overs at that time. And what they're doing is taking the plastics out of the overs. Brian has experimented quite a bit with trying to remove plastics. He's using a European plastic removal system, which is probably about 80% effective. He's also has another plastics removal machine built by another Canadian up in Whitehorse that does actually about 95% of the plastics removal. It's just a bit slower. And so at this point in time, Brian isn't using that because he's got so much material going through. But it's a societal commitment that we need to make to this because it is costly.
Thanks, John Paul. I think that answers Shannon's question. Hi, Shannon. She was also asking about what the most successful screening solution is for non-compostable material. So I think that answers that question. We have another question from Helen that says that she lives in a small acreage surrounded by bush and has bears and wolves and coyotes and all of the usual things that live in the forest, and is wondering how to manage the composting so that it doesn't become a wildlife attractant. Have you encountered that, Andrea? Have you encountered animals coming to the compost piles?
Yes and no. We have had coyotes that have wanted to kind of make a little den in there because it's really nice and warm. But the thing that I have that kind of works for us is that compost is only out there from May to maybe September, and then it's gone. And then the whole compost pad is clean until May again. So it doesn't sit out there for very long. So it's not an attractant for very long. The only other feedback I would have, and I don't know how big scale, but the thing that we do to kind of keep animals out of our dead pile, it's a necessary evil, it's one of those things we have to have, but is we make a little spot for them and you put a gate in front of it, and for whatever reason it works. I don't have bears though, so I can't comment on that, but it works for the coyotes. They don't want to go through that gate if it's just even a little bit of a fence around it, but doing that on a large scale probably isn't very feasible.
Brian, John Paul, has Brian is accepting food waste, right? So that's a different scenario altogether. Do you have different, there must be a whole slew of vectors who are interested in accessing that pile.
Yeah, food waste in particular is a big attractant. So seagulls, even though you're far away from the sea, is one big one. I've seen the most beautiful bald eagle conservation area by a compost pile doing fish waste. But in terms of bears, wolves, and coyotes, the general rule is if you receive the material, get it into process and get the temperature up quickly. They're not as attracted to it. So 30 years ago, when I was working with Ag Canada, we were right up against the mountain where the bears, we would have 7 or 8 bears rolling around in the cornfields. We composted dead chickens in an open bin and found that no animals, no bears, no wolves, no coyotes, of which there were many of them, never bothered. They started to take a sniff. And I think part of the principle is if we can get the temperature up pretty fast, these animals don't want to burn their noses. But short of that, it's going to have to be good fencing.
Thank you. There's another question on valuing compost, which is something we'd spoken a little bit about in the first webinar. I think it's an ongoing sort of challenge and question and developing, concept. Andrea and Colby, the question is for Andrea, how did you begin to value your compost when you're selling it to farmers and landowners? And then does your price change based on tests or differences in input?
I wish it did. I wish I could sell it on a dry matter basis, because what happens is that you dry it down and the nutrients are still there, but it weighs less, right? So I wish I could get to the point where we could sell it on a dry matter basis and we could apply it on a dry matter basis. So then you're not applying 4 metric ton, you're applying 2, because on a dry matter basis, however, we're not quite there yet. We sell ours right from my yard at $20 a metric ton. And then they're responsible for the trucking and then the spreading and everything after that is the farmer's cost. We haven't gone up very much. I technically think that I probably should, because the cost of the straw going into the animal and then out the animal and into the rows has gone up so significantly, but I think you could outprice yourself and then it wouldn't be as valuable to the people that are around me. There's definitely been a widespread uptake in using compost, obviously, in my area. It's definitely a more cost-effective way to add nutrients to your soil, not to mention all the other benefits. But we're not quite to the point where it's the only thing. I hope that answers your question.
And Colby, do you have thoughts on that? Have you got, I think you said that you were going to land apply the compost to your own farm. Is that your plan at the moment?
Yes. So I guess the only, there's one other community that we know of that was selling it for $8 a ton, and the farmer had to pick it up, and he had to take all the costs associated with it from the site. As far as the benefits, it's I guess that's why there needs to be more research, and that's where we're going to start applying this to the land and start with, like, I want to do a soil health test on all my land and see how it's progressing and get the soil scientists in there and see, get some actual numbers to get a better picture of the actual value of this stuff.
Perfect. Thank you. We have another question from Tammy Burke that asks if there's any change in weed growth when land applying compost. I did not direct that at anyone. Andrea, you took your mute button off. You look like you have an answer.
I can. I can answer a little bit. Just the act of actually composting, if it's done right, will kill the weed seeds just because of the high temperatures. So I've had people that have applied compost and got an influx of weeds. Weeds are a first succession plant. So when there is bare soil, weeds are going to be the first thing that comes in when you add nutrients, such as compost. So what's happening is you're supercharging and the weeds are saying, oh, yay. But the second succession plants will come in. But I don't think, I always have this argument with people. The weeds aren't coming because of the compost. It's coming because your soil's coming back alive and the first succession plants are coming in. And as long as you could do your compost right, the weed seeds won't be there.
Excellent. Thank you. We have another interesting question from Jawed Farhad, who works for the City of Edmonton, and he's asking, he says, how do you get farmers to buy your compost? Because most of the farmers that the city speaks with say that they only want chemical fertilizer due to the low nutrient value in compost compared to fertilizer. It sounds like you're mostly selling to people who kind of have their heads wrapped around what's in that compost and what the outcomes are, or what does that look like for you, Andrea?
I think my context is a little bit different probably than Edmonton, just because of the high value crops that we have. And so they're constantly trying to put into their rotation potatoes and onions. And so part of that is rehabilitating the soil. So they have a little bit of a knowledge of that. But as soon as you start talking about the biology and that kind of thing, you can kind of see their eyes glaze over. And some people can go there and some can't. And that's just how it is. What we do is we send a soil, or not a soil, a compost sample away, and we get it analyzed so that I can tell you chemically what is exactly there. And so I have our whole, like since 2007, all of our compost, I have the biology analyzed and then the chemical analysis also done. And so that kind of gives you a little bit of leverage, and then you can compare that to what chemical fertilizer would cost and what you're getting in compost in a non-synthetic way. So that's the way I combat it, but I'm in a different context than Edmonton. So, yeah.
Sorry, I was muted. Are you marketing your compost to the farms around you, or so you're still proactively going out and offering it?
Oh yeah. I have the same people that kind of come back every year, but some years I have more, some years I have less. So yeah, I'm constantly, it's actually on my to-do list this week, but yeah, I'm constantly marketing it. Yeah.
Okay. Colby, have you thought about that, or like, I guess, have you found any resources that would be helpful?
What was he asking again?
Just like, I guess, have you spoken to your neighbors or other farmers around you and sort of gotten a sense of what, how they view the value of compost compared to the value of chemical fertilizer?
I guess it depends on who you talk to, but I guess myself, I've always had livestock. So I've always seen the benefits of what livestock manure can do to the soil firsthand, but lots of young farmers don't want to have anything to do with livestock, and they've only, I guess, they went to school and they were taught the conventional way of farming, which is all synthetics, and so that's just what they grew up with and that's what they're used to. So I guess there needs to be more research and in our area to prove that this stuff, I guess, to increase the value of it and show how well it works, is I would say. And another thing, I know with the City of Edmonton, everybody thinks, well, the closer the better to the city. Well, no, that's not the case, because I know when I worked, I was trying to get biosolids on my farm from Edmonton and trying to propose a way better way of doing it, more environmentally friendly. And unfortunately, they didn't go for it. But these farmers right around the city, they get this biosolids, they get it for free. They just spread it on and work it in the soil, which kills soil structure. And it's just a horrible way of doing things. And these farmers, they put this free fertilizer on, and then they go and top it up with another $100 an acre of synthetic fertilizer. So they're getting a very good deal, and they're close to the city. So, you know, they've already got it made because their land is worth a lot of money. So it's just an added bonus. Whereas you get, so location, like I say, the further away you go, there's port where I live, we have like five different types of soil in one field. I have beach sand to black number one soil. So I guess when you go to the city, there's very good soil around there, and it's hard to see the difference in I guess applying fertilizer on three types of soil as opposed to just good soil. So I feel that the little further away you haul it to get it processed, but you reach a circumference of farmers, a large area with more variable land, and I feel it would benefit the more producers.
Just, I guess, to build on that, like when we were talking about doing this study, one of the things that we looked at was the location as well, right? Like the city of Edmonton and city of Calgary, I mean, city of Calgary has a compost facility up and running. City of Edmonton seems to be in the works, and one is perhaps on the way in the next couple of years. We'll see what happens. There's all of these other municipalities across Alberta who are in the same situation where they would have to haul material. And from the waste management perspective, there's a nice radius for that as well, right? You don't want to be hauling material too far. So I think that we were hoping that the opportunity, there would be sort of a little bit of a symbiosis between the local farmers and the municipality who's looking to manage their organic material. So just a little bit of context there. What else have we got for questions here? I think that this is a, there's a question, this is for you, John Paul. What are the concerns if you do not use a working surface and just have the compost piles on bare earth?
There's a couple of things there. One, it's a regulatory concern. So the regulations require an impervious surface. And so that can either be a clay liner or a synthetic liner, or asphalt or concrete are considered impervious liners as well. So if you're working on a bare soil surface, yeah, there's the risk of nutrients and bacteria migrating away into ground and surface water. That's why the regulation is there. And then from a practical perspective, and we've seen this often, is even if you're working on a surface that drains away really nicely, it's that fine organic material will block those pores very quickly, and you will have a challenging working surface to run your loaders on.
Thank you. Great answer. There's another question here. I think actually, John Paul, maybe this one is for you, and then Colby. The question is, do farmers get paid a tipping fee for receiving compost? So I guess, yeah, do they get paid? And what does that look like sort of contractually and by ton? And what can a farmer anticipate seeing in that space?
There's definitely a tipping fee paid to the farmers, because it is a lot of work to produce a good compost. And so and this is the concern that Brian raised with me. I remember telephone conversations 8 years ago. Oh, John, that's a lot of money for that piece of equipment. And what's the future of composting? Like, is it going to be worthwhile? And I kept saying, Brian, with your operation, with your ingenuity, the fact that you're using compost on the farm, you will be the last composter standing in Alberta. I can guarantee you that. But there is a cost to doing it all, and it's a cost to doing it right. And so there's a huge investment to be made. And so typically the contracts will need to be a minimum of 10 years with the communities or wherever the organic material is coming from. And that cost, you know, can range from $30 to $75 or even $100 per ton, depending on the nature of the material. But we have to be really careful as we encourage this, that we keep the bar high in terms of the requirements for good composting. We need to be able to deal with the plastics. And so we don't want to get caught where, okay, I've taken a contract for $20 a ton, but I forgot that there's all this plastic material in there. So I'm just going to spread it out in the field. Society loses as a result of that. All of society does. So we need to keep encouraging each other to keep that bar high. And let's do this right so we don't mess it up for everybody.
Thank you. Colby, do you have anything to add in there?
Pretty much just what John Paul said. Like, it does cost a lot of money and it's a big investment. And, you know, farmers, I don't have a lot of money, I guess. So we're trying to do it as cost effective. And as farmers, we are pretty ingenuitive and cost effective and utilize, you know, every, I guess, string of wire and everything. So we're, I guess, building these facilities practical. And I think John Paul is great. You know, he's from a farm and seems like he builds his facilities just like with Brian. They're very straightforward. And because myself and my partners, we've toured facilities that are world-class facilities, but just over-engineered and just, you know, that's taxpayers' money. And why waste that? You know, there's so many better things we can do with our money. Everybody needs more money. So, the simpler, the better. You know, they talked about, I mean, you look at that City of Edmonton facility, what a disaster that was. And you talk about overcomplicated. And, you know, it's just like buying a fancy tractor to feed cows. Why do you need a GPS and all this other stuff to feed your cows? You know, it's just money not well spent. So simple is better. And like John Paul said, I guess we're finding as we're starting up that these municipalities have programs in place already. So we can't come in and make these demands that we don't want this in our compost. We don't want that. We just got to start the program with what they have and just help them make it better. And it's a transition, right? But we got to start somewhere. And so that's kind of what we're finding, I guess.
That's a great answer. Thank you. Okay, we have 1 minute left. There's one question that I think is really important that we try and address here. There's a question from Peter Duck that says, can John Paul comment on the Compost Council and industry CQA certification process as a tool for giving municipalities and neighbors confidence in well-run compost facilities, as well as giving facility operators some quality branding? So I think the question is, how do we sort of instill some confidence here in the product and in the facility? John Paul, I'm going to give you one extra minute to answer that, and then we'll break here.
Yeah, it's part of how do we raise the bar? The goal of the Compost Council is to raise the bar for composting so that we can have a greater level of confidence. The part of the CQA process is sort of peer-to-peer evaluation and encouragement of best practices for composting. So it is a good part of the process. Also, in the CQA process, there's the safety requirements for compost and, you know, how's the compost valued. So that is encouraging as well. The Alberta guides, the nutrient management guide and the code of practice gives absolutely excellent guidance on best practices for composting as well. So I think you have a lot of good resources right here in Alberta already in terms of how to raise that bar.
Thank you. I think there's a couple more questions. Thank you so much, everybody, for, as Shannon just said, thank you for your fantastic presentations and for your input. It's really, really important for us to be able to hear about the on-the-ground operational examples of what's happening and what could be. So thank you very much. If anyone wants to stick around, I there are maybe two more questions that we could take. Just a reminder too that the user guide is now on Recycling Council of Alberta website under resources. So go check it out and let us know if you've got questions. As I said in the last webinar, we'd be interested in hearing feedback on whether it was useful and also what how the Recycling Council of Alberta can help in next steps and understanding kind of what you need as municipalities and as farmers and landowners. So let us know what you'd like to see and we'll see what we can do to support. What else is in here? There's a question about compost facilities diversifying between some focused on waste diversion and some focused on producing compost. Do you want to take that for 30 seconds, John Paul? Do you think there's a possibility of seeing facilities doing either one or the other?
It sounds like the question is, if I'm a farmer and I'm focusing on waste diversion, the question I have to ask as a farmer is, why am I doing this? And the primary purpose for on-farm composting, and it's supported from a regulatory perspective, is that you're recycling the organic matter back to the land. If that's not the primary objective, then it probably shouldn't be done on the farm. So really the whole goal that I see of this initiative to recycle organic matter and nutrients back to the farm is so that we can return that to the soil. If it's about waste diversion, we can do that anywhere.
Thanks.
I guess I could comment on that, working with the Westlock landfill and seeing what the manager does there. He has a recycle facility for plastics and cardboard. And we see so much more potential because farmers are so resourceful and we utilize everything. There is no such thing as waste on our farms. There's potential for making plastic posts out of the plastic we sort. And, there's a lot more, I see a huge potential on working with landfills to create more products to be used in agriculture or whatever, and to just build on the compost side of things as well.
That's a really interesting perspective. Thank you. That is, I think, the burgeoning circular economy right there. Okay, my final just comment is that there's a couple of resources that people have added. Shannon Ripley, thank you. There's a great link in here to wildlife fencing for animals. And there's a comment as well from Peter Duck, just offering up that if anyone wants to be in touch about their composting history and where their composting has taken them and their interaction with animals in the Bow Valley, he would be happy to discuss it. So thank you very much, everybody. We'll leave it here. We're happy to hear your feedback and have a great rest of your day.